This is my 1960 FLH Harley-Davidson, and it's one of my good riders, really. We restored this about, a dozen years ago, and then took it down to Daytona, put it in the concourse down at the Speedway, and ended up coming in second, beaten out only by an MV Agusta. So we were quite pleased to do that. It's unusual in that all of the accessories on it are period accessories that I had been collecting over the years, so there's not a lot of aftermarket on this bike, unless it's old period aftermarket, like buco pieces and things like that. Beautiful paint job on it. The black and white really set the bike off, and it has extra chrome on it too to kind of give it a little special. It's got a lot of accessories on it with the directionals and the spotlights and the cigarette box here behind the windshield. This bike's got K-bags on it too, which are new old stocks. They're right off a dealer's shelf, not a mark on them. And of course, being the FLH, it was a fairly strong bike in its day because the FLH came with higher compression and it came with a higher lift cam in it too. This has got the King of the Road seat on it. Very big, comfortable seat, and of course that's part of the suspension on it. These bikes came in with rear suspension, which came out in 58. So you had rear suspension, you had rear hydraulic brakes, good front suspension, but you also had the sprung seat. So the sprung seat would be lovely going down the highway, and when you had your passenger on behind, you put up the buddy helper springs, and that would support their weight too and still give you some spring to the seat. The trumpet horn on these were very loud, so they worked very well in letting people know you were coming. This has got some nice touch smaller accessories on it too, like the spare spark plug holder and the ball end levers.
The Great Wall Street stock market crash of 1929 hit the economy with a vengeance. That year, Harley-Davidson sold 21,000 motorcycles. In 1930, sales dropped to 17,000. By 1933, the company sold less than 4,000 units. It was a disaster. The four founders, William H. Davidson, Walter Davidson Sr., Arthur Davidson, and William S. Harley, were now old men. They and their families were, however, financially secure. Still, they considered closing the factory. Whether it was because of loyalty to their employees or simply a refusal to call it quits after 30 years of hard work, Bill Harley and the Davidsons decided to carry on. They invested a lot of money and time into their new knucklehead engine. This finally enabled them to put their sales ahead of Indian. In 1930, Indian was taken over by DuPont, and their bikes were offered in a wide range of attractive colors. Not to be outdone, Harley-Davidson soon followed suit. Dark drab hues were replaced with eye-catching reds, oranges and creams, two-tones, and stylish Art Deco tanks. Harley's answer to the Indian Big Chief 80 cubic inch big twin was the 1935 VLH. By increasing the stroke to 4 1/4 inches, Harley was able to build their biggest motor yet. The knucklehead took 5 years to develop and was finally introduced in 1936. The delay was caused by a shortage of engineering staff, oil leaks, and a new dry sump lubrication system, which did away with the antiquated total loss oil system. This meant a constant supply of fresh, cool oil, which allowed more reliable high-speed operation. The knucklehead had big valves, high compression, and produced 40 horsepower at 4,800 RPM. This 61 cubic inch overhead valve engine was mated to a 4-speed gearbox and became known as the 61E. Around that time, Joe Petrelli set a new speed record of 136.1 miles per hour with a tuned knucklehead and high top gear ratio. Police officer Fred Hamm broke the 24-hour record, riding a standard knucklehead 1,825 miles for an average speed of 76 miles per hour. Harley now had a bike that was both fast and reliable. In 1940, the 80 cubic inch side valve received aluminum heads for better cooling, and 1941 saw a 74 cubic inch version of the knucklehead. It featured a new centrifugally controlled oil pump, which solved oil distribution problems. Most of these bikes were used by the military during World War II. The company considered building a smaller 45 cubic inch knucklehead, but the idea was dropped because of the high manufacturing costs. It would be nearly 20 years before Harley-Davidson finally built an overhead valve baby V-twin, the Sportster. In 1948, the Springer front forks were replaced with telescopic ones and the Hydroglide was born. Gradual updates followed with foot shifting in 1952, rear suspension in 1958, 12-volt electrics in 64, and electric start in 1965.